Hello everyone, welcome to our second concert of the season. We are very happy to see you, live audience. Yes, the pandemic is not over, so we're trying to be as careful as possible. All the musicians are vaccinated, we play with masks, and also we keep streaming our live concerts. And this is all possible because we get wonderful support. So I have a list of all the supporters so that I don't forget anybody. Ohio Arts Council, Greater Columbus Arts Council, the Puffin Foundation for our outreach concerts, mostly Columbus Foundation, Ingram White Castle Foundation, Johnstone Fund for New Music, and the National Endowment of the Arts. And of course, all of you individual donors. We cannot do this without the audience, without you, of course. I forgot to actually say who I am. I am Mariko Kaneda. I am the senior program advisor is my title. I'm actually a pianist. And I've been involved in doing the Sunday Central series for many years. So we have, just I need to do this little publicity. If this is the first time that you are here or you're watching us and you would like to know about our future concerts, you can send us an email, sundayatcentral@gmail.com, and we can put you on an email list. The next concert is going to be next year on January 15th with Schubert Octet. It's not going to be in this location. We are going to Ohio History Connection. And then we are going to have another concert on March 15th. Didn't do my homework. I believe that's the 15th with Bach Concerti. So that's a small ensemble. A lot of violin concerto. Oops, sorry, Siri is talking. And then the last concert in May is going to be piano duet. I think this is the first time we're going to do a piano four hands. And it's publicized on the postcard that it's going to be in Ohio History Connection, but we found another location. It's going to be on Broad Street Presbyterian Church, where we found a magnificent Bösendorfer. So we're very much looking forward to go in there. So today we have a string quartet. Two string quartets, Haydn and Beethoven, and their names. It's the Joke and the Harp. It's going to be performed by Noname String Quartet, N-O-N-A-M-E. I think you get it. So this group, they just got together this week to rehearse and prepare this concert. Now, we all know, I'm sure that many of you, you're familiar with them. Pei-An, of course, because she is very much involved with our group. Belinda, the violist, she actually played the first concert of this season. She was also here many times before. David Brickman, if you remember, he was here also a couple of years ago with Mendelssohn Octet. And the second violin, that's the first time that she's playing with us, and actually she's the newest member of the Columbus Symphony. So I expect that she's going to be involved also in our future concerts. David is going to be talking about today's programs, and he's going to go into details about why these string quartets have that title. I think you'll enjoy hearing what he says. I was there the other day. He was very good. So enjoy, enjoy the concert, and please welcome the Noname String Quartet.
Hi, welcome. We're so glad to see everybody. I just wanted to say a few words because you probably noticed that David Neva is not here today. And so I texted him saying, hey, David, do you want me to tell any jokes? Because if you know David, he likes jokes. And he's actually the one that named our quartet the No Name Quartet. So, haha, right. It's they're all bad jokes. So the first thing he said, well, tell the audience to turn on their phones after the concert. Okay, so that was the first bad joke. And then he said, well, why don't you tell them the joke about why couldn't Beethoven find his piano teacher? Does anybody know the answer? He was Haydn. But as I am known to do, I like to one-up David. Usually I'm successful. So I say, well, Beethoven couldn't find his piano teacher because he was Haydn behind his Bach. And anyway, with no further ado, here is what. So here's the other David to tell you a little bit about our program.
Well, I'm so happy to see everybody here, and I'm so happy to not see, but know that you're present there online. I also know that nobody has a program in his or her hands, and so I'd like to just tell you what we're going to play. We're going to play two works today, the first by Haydn and the second by Beethoven. They both are named quartets. I don't believe either was named by the composer. The Haydn quartet is called the Joke Quartet, and I'm going to just go through movement by movement. The joke actually, we think, is comes from the fourth movement. I'm just going to give you a few little things to hang on to. Written program notes are kind of nice because you can read them as you go along. So I'm gonna be moderate here and try not to overload anybody's brain. But just a few little footholds can really make a difference, I think. So in the first movement, if you'll pay attention to just the first three notes, it's not even a theme, it's just, I guess we would call it a motive in music. Ba-da-da. These three notes, and you'll hear this, how Haydn uses these three notes throughout the whole movement. And, you know, we often don't think about it, but this kind of technique gives cohesion to the piece, and it helps it make, helps it, the piece hold together and make sense. And the second movement is a scherzo. A scherzo is basically like a fast waltz. And this one in particular has a kind of interesting and unusual, maybe even unique marking in my part, in the first violin part, where in the middle section, a contrasting section, I actually see fingerings notated in my part. And this was all the way back from original sources. And the fingering suggests that I should use the same finger on consecutive notes, which suggests that there should be a connection between them or a slide. And so we talked about it at length. Is this just the composer's way of wanting it to be very vocal? Because you know when somebody sings, there's like a little connection between the notes. And so that was one possibility. And another thought was, well, maybe it's supposed to be humorous, or maybe it's supposed to sound a little bit tipsy or drunken or something like that. So we opted, since it's called the joke, we opted for the slightly tipsy version of this. So if you hear me smearing around a little bit, it's on purpose. And then the third movement, largo e sostenuto, that means quite slowly and very sustained. And this starts out with a duet. It's written as this, almost as if we're like a horn call kind of intervals, but it's very slow. And I think of it as a love song. And then it recurs again in the two violins. And then the cello plays this kind of winding figure. And then there's one other kind of spiky idea. Pum, pum, pim, ta-da, pum, pum. And again, Haydn makes economical use of just these few ideas and holds this quite beautiful movement together that way. And then finally, we come to finale presto, which means the last movement quite quickly. And this is where the joke comes in. The form of this movement is rondo, and that just means there's a theme that is presented, and then there's something else that happens, and then you come back to it, and then it goes away again, and this theme keeps coming back. And at the end of the piece, is anybody familiar with the Farewell Symphony of Haydn? So in this symphony, people start leaving the stage, and pretty soon it's just two violins. It's a symphonic work, and there are just two violins left at the end. This work also disintegrates in a sense. That rondo theme just kind of breaks up into its little component pieces. So don't be fooled into clapping prematurely. You'll hear the large gaps, and you'll hear this rondo theme just fragment, and the last little utterance that you hear is also the very first few notes of the movement. So now we will present to you the Haydn String Quartet, subtitled The Joke.
Thank you. Thank you.
on to the much larger second work of the program, the Beethoven Quartet, which is known as the Harp, another one-syllable title. This quartet is also in four movements, and they roughly have, the four movements are roughly the same. It's typically quicker movements on the outside and a slower movement and a minuet or scherzo in the middle too. In this case, the harp, the nickname or the subtitle comes from material in the first movement. This piece starts off lost. So you'll hear that it seems almost as though someone is feeling their way. And Beethoven achieves this through harmonies that are not obvious. And so harmonically, it's feeling its way. We're not sure what key we're heading up, we're heading towards. And this slow kind of opening period, opening passage lasts, so maybe a minute or two. And then comes a very obvious Beethoven-like motive, pum, 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 this slow arpeggiated figure. And just like Haydn built a whole movement out of a few notes, much of this material in this first movement is built on those three notes. And in particular, you'll hear not me, but my three colleagues playing iterations of these three notes, and they're plucked. They're played pizzicato, which just means we pluck the strings like a harp or a guitar. And the operative word here, of course, is harp. And you'll hear that. I play some of that too now that I come to think of it. And one other interesting feature of this music is towards the end of it, suddenly the first violin player, that's me, just kind of goes ape. And somebody said it sounds like Charlie Daniels. And you'll hear this very rapid, almost fiddle style music. And it's quite a rousing. Close to this movement. Now, the slow movement is a theme and variations in sort of a loose form. You'll hear the most heart-melting theme presented first in the first violin. My colleagues are playing a low, kind of hushed underpinning harmonically, and the violin is like a great soprano singing quietly on the top of it. For me, this slow movement, it's quite a large movement, and I feel it's the heart of this piece. In it, Beethoven does what, for me, is the of all his many great traits, his ability to express the profundity of human experience. He demonstrates that in this beautiful slow movement. Following that are the last two movements, which are played without pause. So again, it would be possible to get confused here. The third movement is a scherzo, unlike the Haydn scherzo, which is kind of rustic and charming. This scherzo is frenetic and aggressive at times, and you'll hear it alternating with a trio section, which is even more pedal to the metal, we could say in the vernacular. The cello barrels away with some scales. And then the scherzo material comes back a few times. You'll hear Beethoven do one of his great tricks. He does it in the Seventh Symphony scherzo. And that is, he takes this aggressive, intense music and he asks us to play it very quietly. And so it's the same music, the same rapidity, the same intensity, or perhaps even more so because of its withheld or its held back nature. And then this movement kind of slows down, winds down, and leads to a beautiful variations movement. It starts out with more of a typical kind of format where there's eight bars and another eight bars, each section repeated, boom, the theme is done. Eight bars of a first variation, another eight bars, the first variation is done. And he goes on like this for a while, but then at the end it gets more free. It almost gets wispy and lost, and then there's great hijinks at the end, and it leads to a pretty happy close after all of this searching and angst. He gives us the relief we desire. So here is Beethoven, the Harp String Quartet.
Thank you.
Thank you.